In the 1960s, there was significant interest in developing a hybrid aircraft with vertical short takeoff and landing capabilities. Thus, the Air Force, Navy, and Army participated in the creation of the first tri-service VSTOL aircraft, the Ling-Temco-Vought XC-142. Several attempts had already been made, but the XC-142 was the most ambitious at the time, and also the largest. Moreover, the civilian applications of such a machine would potentially revolutionize air travel. After all, like Thomas Edison put it as far back as 1905, quote, "The airplane won't amount to a damn thing until they get a machine that will act like a hummingbird. Go straight up, go forward, go backward, come straight down, and alight like a hummingbird." First Tri-Service VSTOL. In 1959, a government advisory group recommended a full-size, tilt-wing VSTOL aircraft that would meet the specific needs of the Navy and the Army. The goal was to improve existing helicopters for transport-type missions by achieving longer ranges and higher speeds to support operations over considerable distances. Hence, the XC-142 program was born. The largest aircraft of its type was to meet several requirements in addition to vertical takeoff and landing, and the objective was for it to potentially cover many civilian uses apart from its invaluable military applications. The group made it clear that all previous VTOL attempts had been developed to test a specific principle and to prove that it could be accomplished. Consequently, few of these concepts had operational capabilities, which required the XC-142 to be tested directly in operational environments. It was then decided that the new aircraft would meet the requirements of all three branches of service, giving birth to the first tri-service VTOL model. Compared to previous efforts, the XC-142 was an ambitious program with optimistic performance goals. While the cost of development would be shared equally by the three branches, the Tri-Service Assault Transport Program would be under the leadership of the Navy's Bureau of Naval Weapons. On January 27, 1961, an agreement was settled after a series of Department of Defense actions, and the request for proposal was issued. The American conglomerate Vought eventually entered a proposal that combined their own engineering, but that implemented the helicopter experience from aeronautical companies Ryan and Hiller. And by September, Vought Hiller Ryan was announced as the winner. The project's main contractor was Vought Aeronautics Division of Ling-Temco-Vought. The subcontractors were Ryan, in charge of the empennage, aft section, engine nacelles, and wing, and Hiller, responsible for the transmission system, selected components, and the flap and aileron. Soon after, a contract was signed for five prototypes, with a specified first flight date set for July of 1964. Initially, the design was named Vought Ryan Hiller XC-142, but it was then dropped after Vought joined the LTV Aerospace Corporation. In January of 1962, the primary design phase started, and the original outline was drafted as a replacement of the Sikorsky HR-2S. The payload needed to be 10,000 pounds, while the operational radius had to be extended to 250 miles. Cruising speed was specified at 250 to 300 knots, and its maximum airspeed at 300 to 400 knots. As for the Marine Corps, the fuel load was required to be reduced without exceeding a maximum gross weight of 35,000 pounds, provided that a 100 nautical mile radius was maintained. Concerned about the propeller downwash being too strong, the Navy opted to exit the program entirely while the prototypes were still being developed. Design and development. The XC-142 weighed around 22,595 pounds while empty, and about 34,474 pounds when fully loaded. Its fuselage was 58 feet 1 inch long, and its wingspan was 67 feet 6 inches long and 26 foot 1 inch high. The fuselage was stout, intended to carry considerable cargo, and its inner compartment was enough for 32 equipped troops, or 8,000 pounds of cargo. A single tall vertical tail provided 129 square foot area, whereas the wing area encompassed 534 square feet. Meanwhile, the high-mounted wings were fitted with trailing double-slotted flaps along each wing. Fuel capability amounted to 370 liters, with a planned capacity for auxiliary tanks for added range. in terms of power. Four 3,080 horsepower GE T64 GE1 engines were mounted on the wings in pods and cross-linked. Each one drove an enormous four-bladed Hamilton Standard fiberglass propeller, which was 15.5 feet in diameter. Hamilton Standard upgraded the propellers later in the program to the 2FF, featuring a wider platform, rounded tips, and a more pronounced twist than that of the previous 2EF blades. This change aimed to overcome a static load problem by improving the aerodynamic load distribution. A fifth three-bladed fiberglass propeller was driven by the four main engines. It was mounted in the tail, rotating horizontally, and interconnected through a gear and shaft train. If up to three engines failed, there was still enough power for the five propellers. However, the setup was highly complex. The rotation was brought together at the top of the fuselage through cross-shafting gearboxes from each engine. The power was then sent back to the tail rotor by a tail propeller shaft and into the gearbox. The propulsion for the experimental airframe was overpowered. If the XC-142 lost an engine during takeoff, it could still clear 50-foot obstacles in 400 feet while carrying almost 10,000 pounds. If all the engines were operating, the rate of climb at sea level was 6,800 feet per minute. For control during ascent, there was a differential propeller pitch that regulated roll, a tail rotor that managed pitch, and propeller slipstream deflection provided by ailerons that manipulated yaw. The main lift system had a unique capability to rotate 98 degrees, more than the expected vertical position, while the mechanism of the unique tilt wing included a central hydraulic motor that drove two screwjack actuators. Constant or variable rate switches on each collective lever controlled the tilt, allowing the aircraft to hover stationarily in a tailwind. The center and outbound sections of the double-slotted trailing edge flaps doubled as ailerons. Although the flaps were programmed to automatically shift with wing tilt, the pilot could override the process. On the other hand, the slats on the leading edge suppressed the stall. Mounted on the outboard of each nacelle, the slats also operated automatically as a function of flap position. Meanwhile, the slab-type horizontal tail assembly was supported by a vertical tail and operated as a standard rudder and fin configuration. But the most significant technology in the system were the dual cockpit controls, conventional rudder pedals, control sticks, and collective levers for takeoff and landing. This intricate control system with artificial field forces powered by dual independent hydraulic systems made the design stand out. Considering logistic implications, the tail rotor was rigged to fold, reducing storage length to diminish the chances of damage during loading. The design was completed within 33 months, and the first model was finally fabricated, ground-tested, and flown. Up in the air. In early 1964, the first prototype was accepted and delivered to the Air Force, and its first flight happened in September. However, its first hover took place 3 months later, and it did not complete a transition until another 2 months. The remaining prototypes soon followed. Suitability testing began at and around Edwards Air Force Base in the fall of 1965. Many test hours were logged in various locations in California and the Pacific. The XC-142 was tested above ground in natural conditions, with a firm subsurface and 3 inches of loose land. No cleaning up was done, and no debris was removed. Keeping the wing angle at 25 degrees or less could minimize ingestion for short takeoff and landings. Although dust clouds obscured the aircraft while lifting during vertical takeoffs, the pilot could always see the ground. An intensive testing phase ensued, with dummy cargo drops at different heights and speeds, nose attitudes, and angles. And another testing round with paratroopers exiting the escape hatch at the rear cargo door soon followed, proving that the tail rotor did not interfere with the deployment. By 1966, the aircraft was ready for carrier operation testing, proving its agility in both short and vertical takeoffs and landings from the deck of USS Bennington. That same year, overwater pickups were tested, lifting a man from a life raft. The trial proved the aircraft's rescue and recovery capabilities, showing no problems with the propeller downwash or slipstream turbulence. The program comes to an end. Despite the positive results, an instability issue was detected between 35 and 80 degrees of wing angle at low altitude, along with high side forces resulting from yaw and deficient propeller blade pitch angle controls. Furthermore, vibration and noise in the cockpit proved increasingly annoying and a real challenge for the 39 pilots who flew 420 hours in total. Unfortunately, several accidents significantly damaged the fleet. The second aircraft damaged its wing and propeller during a ground loop in 1965. And in 1966, prototypes 3 through 5 were also damaged by a hard landing in vertical mode, turbine failure, and pilot error. However, the most severe mishap occurred in 1967 near Dallas, Texas, in a heavily wooded area, when Prototype 1 crashed during a rescue simulation under combat conditions and caused 3 fatalities after having flown 148 times successfully. The most significant exposure the model received was in the 1967 Paris Air Show, but it was not enough to keep the program going. Despite its overall success, the XC-142 did not gather enough interest from the market to keep the project alive, and it was concluded that the program did not contribute enough in terms of technology. However, it said that if the mechanical problems were solved, the XC-142 would have soon achieved operational status. The final decision on the disposition of the model was eventually made in the middle of the Category 2 operational suitability, and the only remaining prototype, number 2, is still on display at the Air Force Museum at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base near Dayton, Ohio. Thank you for watching our video. Please leave us a comment and give us a thumbs up if you liked it. And don't miss all our Dark Documentaries channels to learn more about technological military developments and historical anecdotes.